May the words of my mouth and the thoughts together of our hearts be both pleasing and acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. O Lord, have mercy on us. Amen. Beloved in Christ, you may be seated. First friends, grace and peace be to you this day from God our Father, from our Lord, and our blessed Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The foundation for our meditation this morning comes to us from the Holy Gospel, according to St. John, the second chapter, as you heard it, one of those familiar accounts. We find ourselves here in the season of Lent, in the midst of the passion of our Lord Jesus. And so I guess it really doesn't surprise us that Jesus comes into the temple and starts taking a little bit of somebody's tail, huh? Well, that's kind of the way that it sounds. Can you imagine there in the temple? I mean, we get this picture of Jesus coming in, running in with his whip, you know, kind of like Indiana Jones, perhaps, making a mess of the place and people running and screaming and wondering, what is he doing? What is he doing? We respond to Jesus like that an awful lot. We don't understand the role and will of our God. We see his actions and we wonder, what does God have in mind? Very much like this year about the young people, love in our hearts a little different than our theirs. If we were left to make the rules, yeah, we may be a little bit wiser, but guess what? The rules would pretty much benefit us as well. But when the responsibility, the blessing, and the opportunity to care for another is placed upon us, how we think about rules changes. Just like that. I want you to think about that image of our Lord during his passion. That as he entered into the temple precincts, into the temple courts, what he did, the more important, why did he do it? Now there is something to be said for what our Lord makes plain, do not turn my Father's house into a house of prayer. That's something with which I struggle, with which you struggle, I'm sure. We tell ourselves and comfort ourselves that in this day and age, we have to simply be about fundraising because that's just the reality. If you check a history book, my guess is that it was no different back then as it is now. There will always be room for more money. The question is that what we have been sought, or rather taught, to seek after? Don't get me wrong, we need money. And so the practicalities of a church or of a temple, of a family home and a budget shouldn't be lost. We are called to both responsibility and accountability with which the things God blesses us with. There is no question. The scripture makes it plain that the books are open and all the things that we have done, so will we be judged. But thanks unto God that there is another book that is open, the book of the Lamb's Book of Life. And in it your name is written in the very blood of Jesus Christ, indelible and unerasable. It is God himself who has put it there. But I want you to think about Jesus and his driving out the money changers and the traders in perhaps a little different way this morning. You know how the temple was built, right? The temple was a large series of maybe rectangles. On the outer court, you know, big wall, first of all, deep wall, those people that shouldn't be in there out. But when you finally got in there, there was an outer court. And that was called the court of the Gentiles. It was a place where people that weren't Jewish could go. And that's probably where the trading, that's probably where this kind of commerce was going on. But then it took another step, and you went a little bit closer. And that might have been what was called the courtyard of the freedmen. That was people who had converted perhaps to Judaism, but couldn't get real close to God. Maybe one more step in, and a smaller triangle, or rather rectangle, I was never going to change, sorry. And there we have the court of the women. Back in that day and age, the ladies couldn't go quite as close as could the men. Another step in, yet a smaller triangle, and there there was another place then, smaller yet, wherein one man, once a year, would come and stand, the Holy of Holies. And that was the high priest. And his only purpose was to pour out the blood of the sacrifice on the mercy seat of God and come and proclaim to the people, your sins are forgiven you, because God has declared. That was the order of the temple. And that was the order of the religion of the Jews at the time of our Lord Jesus. Many of them mistakenly believed that taking a step closer and closer and closer to God is done by we ourselves. Well, I'll give more this week, and perhaps that will get me a step closer to God. Or perhaps if I only do this nice thing, God will allow me into the next little group. And we try through our lives to move from the outside to the inside. I mean, brothers and sisters, think about our lives, our relationships, our jobs, the way that we work with our children, the way that we recreate. Tell me that it is not all the same. Incremental steps so we can get to where we want to be. But beloved, we cannot come to God in the same way that we work our lives in this world. We cannot offer enough to come from that outer courtyard where the unbelievers exist to finally find our way to the Holy of Holies. Lord, I'm here. Can I come in? But rather, it is God who comes to us. In the Old Testament, the book of Deuteronomy, we are reminded that in fact, God's salvation, His word, His presence is not far from us. The scripture says, it is not across the sea that you need to go and sail to get it. It is not high in the heavens unattainable by man that you must go and retrieve it. But the word of the Lord is near to you. It has come to you. Beloved, I believe more so than our Lord Jesus simply being upset because of the commerce that went on within the temple courts. And that is something that needs to be considered. But I do believe that he was showing us something even more. For he took that money that for us, let's face it, makes the world go round. There aren't one of us here who would give it all up because we simply need it. And that is the reality. While it might make the world go round, it is not the source of our life, nor is it the fountain of our joy, nor is it the place from which we find our hope and security. And so Jesus then, in a wonderful image, takes that money by which so many of the people there in that day and age thought, if I could buy a goat or buy a dove and offer the sacrifice, God will receive me. But it wasn't the sacrifice of the pigeon or the goat that caused God to forgive. It was God's undying love. The sheep and the goats, the practice, the exercise is for you and for me. God's love is not warranted upon our action. For if that were the case, you and I would find ourselves to fall far short. But rather, God chooses not to say, come to me, but rather, I will come to you. And so, with all the animals and pigeons, all that which he cast out, I believe that our Lord is proclaiming, this is not the way to heaven. You cannot buy it though the world says you can. You can offer nothing that finally will provide for you the gift that God would give. There is one sacrifice, and it is not a goat nor pigeon. There is one sacrifice at cost, and it is not the entirety of all the riches of the world. That one sacrifice, that one cost is given in our Lord Jesus Christ, and Him driving out all those from the temple was to proclaim this, that the only way to the Father is by me. For when Jesus concluded those words, having flipped the tables and tossed the money, he said to those, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it. Beloved, the place of worship, the place where our hearts are once more reconciled and joined together with our beloved Creator Father, is in Jesus Christ, His Son, your living and coming Savior. No church building, however beautiful, no congregation, however historically rooted, no gathering of people, no matter how good, how active, how fervent in what they believe they ought to be doing, can open the gates of heaven. That is left alone for the one to whom those keys have been given, even Jesus Christ. And those keys to open and close, to bind and to loose, have been given to you. Through Peter, I give to you the keys to the kingdom. And you know how the doors are open and closed in heaven? Given through the forgiveness that Jesus Christ has poured out upon us. And in it through the grace and forgiveness that God chooses to work in our lives. We have come to know and to believe that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, died for us. But too often we believe that that loss is a big nameless, faceless wrong. We hear about it in Revelation just the other week, chapter 7. And there before me, standing in the white robe, people from all nations, tribes, languages, and tongues. And beloved, although they are innumerable, know this, that God does not simply see you as a number or as one of the mass of the many. Had you been the only human being on this planet, the Lord Jesus Christ would have died for you. So Jesus wasn't proclaiming to them, hey, you screwed up. We should have learned that from that lesson. And we should continue to learn it to this day. But I believe what is driving our Lord is just that. Beloved, do not seek after that which you cannot save. Do not think that you can open for yourself that which I alone can. Do not think that the beauty and the riches of this world can somehow get you closer to God. But rather come to me. Because I am the temple, says Christ. I am the presence of God. I am your Savior. I am the Father of one. When I see the Father do, this is what I do. When I hear the Father say, that is what I say. Dearest friends, Jesus may have cleaned out the courtyard. We learned our lesson of love. And we should continue. But more so, he said this. You cannot destroy what God has established. And that is life and salvation in Jesus Christ. Our sin and the sin of the world drove him to that cross on that day. And he did so willingly for you. That's the heart of evangelism. And that is the heart of each and every one of our vocations and our callings. To be a preacher, teacher, parishioner, worker, husband, wife, son, or daughter. Our vocation is to share and to show that love that Jesus Christ did to show us. It's just in case you didn't know, and I know that you do. We have families, communities, and a world full of people that know that God doesn't love them. And we know the truth. Share that truth. That the love of God is not just for those who think they can work their way in. But rather the love of God comes out to bring those who came into his embrace and his kingdom. Jesus drove out the money changers. He kicked out the animals. And he's filling God's courts with redeemed and reconciled sinners of you and me. Dear friends, let's do the same. So that indeed the banquet hall of our God may be filled. And together we can rejoice. Praise, honor, wisdom, and all thanksgiving to God through Jesus Christ, His Son, our Lord. Amen.